This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello and welcome everybody to a new video from Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth. This is episode 55 and I'm recording this on the 14th of January 2017. It's been quite a while, but I have had a wonderful guest from the United Kingdom over here on my show, Hour of the Truth, Robert Newman. And we did some very interesting shows, two parts actually, dealing with law. With law in the way that you normally do not deal with it. The video was called English Common Law, Equity, Germany and Excellence of History, Part 1 and 2. And that's already a few months ago. But there have been some requests by my viewers if it would be possible to invite Robert once again to Hour of the Truth, that he could expand a little bit more about the law. So this time we came together today on the 14th of January and recorded The Law in the Modern Times. And also this will be a two-part series. The next one we will be recording in 3 days from now, the 17th of January. And then you can watch the videos when they are uploaded. So without any further ado, I will give the mic to my brother in Christ, Robert Newman from the United Kingdom, who will tell us about the law in the modern times. Hello, Robert. It's your part.
Thank you, George. Thank you, George. This is Robert Newman again, and thanks very much for the invitation to talk about some subjects that are not very often discussed. The law in the modern time, and not just the law, because there are many kinds of law struggling. And there's a great confusion about law, generally speaking, everywhere, not just in England, but in Germany and America, across the world, everybody hears about law. What is law? And what are these different forms of law? And do they have anything in common? Or are they just complete confusion? And where does God's law come into all of this? And and how are we to navigate between these different systems, publicly and private? So I'll call this public and private law. This is from my perspective as a student of the law of England and of equity. And then perhaps we can have a discussion about that as we continue.
Absolutely. And first and for all, the question that burns really on my heart is, are we talking about law? To me, as a Bible-believing Christian, Robert, there's only one lawgiver. And that's God.
Yes.
That's the Creator God who created me and created the heavens and the earth and everything that's in it.
Yes.
He is the supreme lawgiver.
Yes.
So with everything that we are talking about, the law that is coming up right now is only dealing with the law of man. And the law of man, in my opinion at least, is absolutely inferior to the law of God. And in my opinion also, that if man learned to cope and deal with the law of God and adhere to the law of God, we wouldn't need all these other laws.
Right.
But I'd like to hear your point on that.
Oh, thank you. Right. Yes, I agree with a lot of what you're saying. You know, of course, that the New Testament tells us that no man is justified by the law.
Law can only condemn us, Robert.
Yeah, the law can only condemn us. And that Paul brilliantly... You notice how St. Paul is under big attack these days from the unbelieving world? Have you noticed that? They hate St. Paul.
I have had a subscriber to my YouTube channel who I blocked eventually after numerous times that I gave him a warning. He always attacked Paul.
Yes.
Saying that he was not a true apostle and all that stuff, and that he was lying and all that stuff.
Yes.
And I tried to give him the point and telling him, listen, if the apostle Paul was not a righteous apostle, first of all, why did God put him in the Bible? Where he left out so many other deceiving things like the book of Enoch and... other gospels that are known today, and the Apocrypha and all that stuff. Leaving that out, but leaving Paul in there.
Yeah.
And second of all, you are denying almost half, if not half, or even more than half, of the New Testament.
Yes.
Because Paul did not only speak to the Romans, Paul also spoke to the Thessalonians, to the Colossians, all these letters to the first seven churches is all done by Paul. Yeah. So when you dismiss Paul, you dismiss everything that he said there.
Yes, yes, yeah. I've noticed as I study more that there are a very large section, very vocalized section, of the church of the theological world, and also the Jewish world, it has to be said, who are very hostile to St. Paul. Christianity, they say, will be so much easier if St. Paul was not around.
For the Jews, it would be so much easier if Jesus had never come, right?
because they deny his
coming anyway.
Exactly.
And they don't accept the New Testament because they don't understand Daniel 9 verses 24 through 27 of the Talmudic Talmudic curse that they are under, and they have not had the possibility to study that. And the Jews in the time of when Jesus came were not taught that their Messiah would come. Because the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees had trouble losing their jobs when Jesus came.
Yeah? Yes.
And so they didn't teach the people. And they taught them, when they taught them anything, they taught them out of the Babylonian Talmud.
Yes.
That stuff that they brought with them from the Babylonian captivity 500 years before.
Absolutely.
And the Jews of that time, and Robert, I think this is the point needs to be addressed to our listeners. The Jews at the time of Jesus' arrival were the same corrupted like the Roman Catholic Church is today.
Absolutely. Oh, I absolutely. And notice that the Lord speaks to the Jews as hypocrites.
Yeah.
Now, I noticed recently a Jewish critic of Jesus, a Jewish critic of St. Paul. He hates St. Paul. He said that the word hypocrite is a Greek word. You cannot find a Hebrew word for hypocrite. And yet Jesus uses the word hypocrite. And I said, but of course Jesus uses the word hypocrite, because these people who claim to be Jews were not actually Jewish. Mm-hmm. They were coming from Gentile areas. That's why Jesus called them hypocrites. And he was really, really adamant that St. Paul was an evil man who had completely controlled, corrupted God's word, and that there was no possible reconciliation between Christianity and the Jewish faith. But that's another question.
Let me please add something to this, because you were speaking about Paul and how Paul always addressed the law.
Yes.
It is imperative to understand that the churches today all teach the law is dead, crucified with Christ.
Yeah.
And that is the reason also why Paul always hammered on the law.
Yes.
If the law is dead, listen closely, and I don't mean you, Robert, you listen always, I know that, but I mean my viewers of the video, listen closely. If the law would be dead, there would be no need for a savior.
Yes.
There would be no need for Jesus Christ to save us.
Yes.
And that is exactly the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church.
Yes, yes.
That's why everywhere you go today, they teach you the law is dead, crucified with Jesus.
Yes,
that was true, there was no need for a savior, because then we would not sin. Because as Paul said, I would not have known sin if I would not have known the law.
Yes.
Only by the knowledge of the law and then transgressing the law, we sin.
Yes.
So if Jesus abolished the law, then we can do what the New Age teaches, what Aleister Crowley taught, do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law, because there is no law anymore. Jesus did not away with the Ten Commandments. Jesus did away with the ceremonial Mosaic law, because all the sacrifices that were made throughout the Old Testament were only a shadow of the things to come, of the perfect Lamb to come, of Jesus Christ, the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world, the only one whose shedding of the blood really can take away sins, because never the killing of an animal could take away sins. It was only symbolic.
Yes.
It was to show the Israelites, this is what is to come. And because you believe this, because of the belief that you have, because of the faith that you have, you are saved. And that is where the Old Testament and the New Testament come together and are the same. Yes. Nobody has ever been saved except by faith, neither in the Old Testament nor in the New Testament. It is the faith that you have, and in the Old Testament they shown this faith through the actions of this sacrificial system that was not necessary anymore. When Jesus came as the fulfilling of Daniel's 70th week from Daniel 9, and he stopped the sacrifices and oblations. He made the sacrifices and oblations to cease in the midst of the 70th week by hanging on the cross and shedding his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. So that means that we are still sinners. How can we be sinners if there is no law? So there has to be a law. Of course, Jesus did not abolish it. And I think this is a very important point to make before we go into all this wonderful law discussion that you prepared here, Robert. And I'm sorry that I had to take over this a little bit, but this is a message that really was on my heart, because there are, as you said yourself, so many people who deny that Paul was a righteous apostle, And if he wasn't a righteous apostle, then the 50% of the New Testament you can put in the garbage can.
Right. Yeah.
And Jesus Absolutely. Would have been a liar and would have been here for nothing.
That's
exactly what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. But please, Absolutely. Back to you.
Oh, thank you. Right. No, I'm in total agree. I totally agree with you. Absolutely, 100% agree with you. I love the New Testament is absolutely perfect. St. Paul knew the law, and that was one of the reasons why he was chosen to do that amazing job as the apostle. He was chosen. He was a prophet sent from God. Mm-hmm. He did things that nobody else could do. His understanding of the law. He was brought up under the greatest lawyer, a law teacher of his time, Gamaliel. No, Gamaliel wasn't nobody. He was a brilliant teacher of the law. And Paul's understanding of the law is just astounding, amazing, never endingly wonderful. But anyway, moving on to the public, and these comments are on the private, and I'm going to say some things that they might challenge your listener. I hope they do. If they don't, I will have failed, because I want to challenge people with some controversial. These are controversial things. A little more than 100 years ago, an atlas of the world would have shown the immense size of the so-called British Empire, you know, in the coloured maps that they had 100 years ago. The British areas or the British colonies, they were pink in colour. I'm sure you've seen this kind of map, York.
Doesn't ring a bell.
Yeah. If you look at a map that is 100 years old and it shows the British territory of, let's say, Australia, mm-hmm. or New Zealand or Canada, or before that it was the United States of America, the Caribbean, Ireland. And
so you're speaking of the Commonwealth then?
Commonwealth, yeah. The British Empire stretched from Canada to New Zealand, from India to South America, it was the largest empire or colonial power in human history.
That's for sure, yeah.
Yeah. Such an atlas, which shows British possessions, so-called British possessions, in pink color, and I'm sure we can find one after we've finished. These British possessions were side by side with Germany had for a time. Germany had possessions in Africa, so did France in North Africa, and many other Western colonial powers had colonies.
Yeah, Germany even in the Pacific realm somewhere.
Even
there.
In the Pacific, yeah, yeah.
Only until the end of the First World War, they were all taken away then, yeah.
Sure. And when you consider the relatively new independence of the USA, which was formerly a British colony also, a part of the British Empire.
Fallen because of a conspiracy, Robert.
Only
fallen because of a conspiracy. And who wants to learn about that should read the book Rulers of Evil.
Absolutely.
And the doings and the workings of the, at that time, general of the Society of Jesus, Lorenzo Ricci.
Yes, yes.
Who did it all. He was reigning between 1758 and plus 1776, because he didn't die in 1775, as they want to make you believe. But I don't want to distract from the subject that we are going on. So,
okay.
But really, for the people who want to study that a little bit, and that the separation from the United States of America from Great Britain was a conspiracy by the Roman Catholic Church, read Rulers of Evil and you will understand that completely.
Okay. So the scale of that empire was remarkable. And this is important because I'm going to come back to the importance of this. It also included India. And I mention all of this British empire, because there is no doubt in my mind that God uses empires, good and bad, to achieve his purposes, his will. He used dictatorships to achieve his purposes. God uses everything to achieve his purposes. Yeah? God is overlooking all of history. All things work together for good. History ultimately achieves God's purpose. Evil will try to do things, but God's will shall prevail. Do you agree with that? Yeah.
Absolutely, I agree on that.
Okay.
Absolutely, because otherwise we would not have chapters in the Bible like Revelation 13, which only speaks about the doings of the dragon, meaning the devil.
Yeah.
The first beast from the sea, which is the Vatican, the second beast from the land, which is the United States of America. It wouldn't speak about, like in Revelation 14, about the false prophet. Of course, God also uses the wicked to achieve his goals. Absolutely.
Yes.
Even without the wicked, he could not even achieve all his goals. He needs the wicked people because he needs the wicked empires. I mean, when we go back to Daniel foresees in Daniel chapter 2 the dream from Nebuchadnezzar, who speaks about four coming Gentile, not Judah, not Israelistic, but Gentile empires.
Yes.
Starting with the Empire of Babylon and his successor Medo-Persia and its successor Greece and its successor and the last empire, Rome.
Yes.
That we are still in today.
Yes.
Those are pagan, heathen, Gentile empires.
Mm-hmm.
And of course they are used to fulfill God's will, because God is sovereign. God is in control. And we as Christians, we understand that they can do whatever they want here in this world. We belong to a kingdom that is not of this world. As Jesus Christ said, if my kingdom was from this world, my people would fight. But we do not fight in this world, because we know that we have a spiritual kingdom.
Right. Okay.
Right.
So I start with the British Empire period, because so much of what I have to say will relate to things and events which happened at that critical time of the late 19th century. I'm going to focus on this when I'm talking about the law system that we have today in Germany, the law system we have today in France or the European Union or Britain or America or almost the whole world, including Britain itself. The law, it all comes from the period of the late British Empire, and I'm going to try to show this. Let's start with one small thing which happened in the late 19th century, which is hardly known in England today. Very few people know this. Lawyers don't know this. Historians don't know this. Academics don't know this. Bible scholars don't know this. Very few people know this. So it's a small thing, but yet it's a big thing. Why is it big? Because people don't know this thing. And in 1895, during Queen Victoria's last years, Cambridge University was the place, the workplace, of a law scholar, a medieval law scholar. He studied old law documents, and, you know, that's what he did. He studied 12th century, 13th century law material, and his name was Professor Frederick William Maitland. And Maitland lived from 1850 to 1906. And Maitland in Cambridge was not the place to go if you studied law. If you studied law, you have to go to Oxford. Oxford had the prestige, Oxford had the reputation, but Cambridge wanted to have their own law department. And Maitland was the first professor to be in Cambridge. And he, for one reason or another, he was chosen to make some of the most spectacular discoveries in the law of England. A great subject, you know, it goes back thousand years or something. In 1895, somebody told him, Professor Maitland, there has been a discovery in the library, not in Cambridge, but in Gloucester, which is about 200 kilometers away. What is the discovery? They have found in the vaults, in the cellar, they found some old documents, and one of them is not a book, but it's a scroll, or a roll. You know what a roll or scroll, yeah?
Sure, like a scroll. In the Bible.
It is a scroll, and this scroll is English, and it dates from 600 years, and it's talking about Parliament and the English Parliament. Would you be interested in having a look at this document? Well, they knew that this document existed because they had other documents of that period, but they'd never had this one. It had disappeared for centuries. But anyway, they found this 1305, one of the oldest records of the English Parliament in London. Professor Maitland quickly decided that, yes, I'll study that. And he arranged for its publication by the Cambridge University. But before they published it, they didn't know at the time what this material would actually contain. Inside this document, he discovered that the Parliament was, there were no political parties in this Parliament. There was no Green Party. There was no Christian Democrat Party. There were no parties at all. There were only individual people visiting the House of Commons during the day to meet the King for private business. And these were private landowners. They were private estate people from all over England. The whole day was taken up with seeing private meetings with the King. They had this or this. And that was the whole day. That was the whole record of the Parliament. A very different Parliament from what we think. We think Parliament is all about democratic parties voting and arguing and debating with each other. But the early English Parliament, Maitland had said this for years, and now he had the evidence, that the Parliament had nothing to do with political parties or democracy. It was all an invention, later invention. It was not there in the 14th century or the 15th century. It didn't exist. There was no Parliament as such. The documentary evidence, Maitland continued after he published this, it created a great sensation with the historians in England who always believed that Parliament was the same as today. They had written books, they just presumed it was the same as it is today, but it wasn't. The government of England was self-governing. It was a self-governing country. The people had an estate. It's true that many people didn't know about the law which relates to the private estate or the private land or private things. They didn't know these things, but some people did know them. And the people who did know them went to see the King. And that was the Parliament of England. And this news, this academic discovery, was soon forgotten. Nobody wanted to hear it. It was interesting, but what's the relevance of that? And that is the subject we're really talking about. Private property, private estates versus the domination of the public government of today. Something happened, right? Something massive has happened. And the something massive is the total control of people's understanding today. It's almost like we are trapped inside a kindergarten, as I said last time I spoke. The kindergarten is controlling you because you don't know that there's the high school exists. The kindergarten system is highly developed today. Government controls everything. Legal government controls everything. And this system has taken centuries to arrive. How did it arrive? It arrived through two things. The creation of civil law. How do you say civil law in German? Civil law.
Zivilrecht.
Sivir, right, okay. The Sivir rect is the best way to explain. If you go to the book of Ecclesiastes, Ecclesiastes 4:12, Jörg, it says,
yeah.
What does it say? That a cord of three strands is not quickly torn apart. You see that?
You have to wait. I'm in my Bible. I'm looking.
Okay, Ecclesiastes.
Okay. Yeah, I just had it here, but.
Okay,
it's a short book. Which chapter?
Yeah. 4.
Chapter 4. Okay. Which verse?
12.
Okay, Ecclesiastes 4:12. Yeah. And if one prevail against him, who shall withstand him? And a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Yeah, threefold cord is not quickly broken. If you're making ropes for, I don't know, for shipping, or you're making rope, the strongest kind of cord that you can make is made of three threads, not mm-hmm. one, three.
Sure.
This cord of three threads is not quickly broken. It is the strongest kind of cord that you can make. This is the Bible, Ecclesiastes 4:12, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you wanted to make a system, which will never break, you would have three strands of a system coming into the country. And the three strands contain everything that they want to do. So the three strands of civil law in Germany today, the three strands of civil law in England, in America, in Iceland, everywhere, the three strands of civil law are always the same. There are three strands, just like three colors of primary colors, yellow, red, and is it blue? Green? Or blue is the other one. Yeah, there are three primary colors. And these three primary colors are in the civil law. They're always the same. In Germany, in England, they're always the same. They are, number one, the first of them is, for civil law, is property. That's the first strand of their civil law system. Property. Yeah? Property, this subject... of property.
That is a very interesting subject the Pope likes very much, because he always speaks of the common good.
Yeah, the common good, yeah.
Meaning that nobody has property, but everything is common good, and you are only allowed to use it as long as it serves the society.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
pure communism. That
absolutely pure communism. Absolutely.
What the Pope teaches there, and it doesn't matter. Yes. It's not only Pope Francis; it has already been Pope Benedict before, and Pope John Paul II before that.
Exactly.
But interesting to remark in this, Robert, is that when Pope Francis visited the United States of America in 2015, in the month of September, and speaking to a joint session of Congress and Senate there, he used the word common good 6 times in that speech.
Ah, really? Okay.
And that is something a lot of people just do not know. And even if they knew, they have no idea where that comes from.
Common good is Jesuits. That's the plantations of Paraguay.
It even goes back further. It goes back to Thomas Aquinas, the doctor of the Church, who wrote this 5-volume monumental work, Summa Theologica.
Sure.
And he came up with the common good because that derives from the old Greek scholars of philosophy.
Those
are the pillars that the Roman Catholic Church is built upon.
Yes, okay, that's the first one, property. Mm-hmm. And this property, this subject defines... And it constitutes the interest which a person can have in things, material things. This subject defines and constitutes the interest which persons can have in material things. So property, that's property. The second cord of the civil control system, it is called obligations. obligation. Mm-hmm. Obligation is the duty or the right or the duties which apply to citizens and their civil obligation, that they're obliged to do something because they're a citizen of the society.
For example, you are obliged to take care of your property.
Yeah, well, obligations are slightly different from property. Yeah, you are obliged to do certain things. If there is an evacuation or something, you're obliged to listen and to obey. And obligation is the duty, and you have certain rights given to you. If you keep these obligations, you have certain legal rights given to you. And this applies to citizens. And these are the areas of civil obligation. So that's the second chord of these three things. And then the third one is the status of persons. It's the status of persons. Some persons have a different status from other people. So there's a status of persons within the civil system. Some people have a higher status, some people have a lower status in the civil system. Yeah, although they claim that everybody's the same, but they're not really the same.
Well, according to the Bible, they are the same.
Yes, according to the Bible, they are.
According to the Antichrist, of course not.
Well, according to the Antichrist wants you to believe in pure communism, which
yeah,
you said,
absolutely. Which,
so it's a complete lie. So there are people who have more faith than other people. There are people who see more things than other people. There are people who play piano better than other people, or who understand carpentry more than other people. People have different talents, abilities. And the ability of these people, or the gifts of these people, are different. And communism can never appreciate that there are human differences. It can never appreciate. They want everybody to conform. But it's hypocrisy, because even in communism, there was an elite ruling class who didn't believe in communism.
Yeah, of course, but there's always a difference between the ruling class and the ruled class.
Yes, exactly.
There always has been a difference in that. But that's why they teach the lay people, if we can call them that, that you are, and this is the first step into Catholicism,
Yes.
That you don't have the right to your own conscience.
Mm-hmm.
The Pope is your conscience.
Yes.
Whereas the Bible says that God is the Lord of your conscience.
Right. Okay.
Whereas the Lord says you have the freedom of speech and the freedom of thought, and you don't have the freedom of speech and you don't have the freedom of thought when you come to the kingdom of Antichrist.
Right. So these three strands of property, obligations, and status of persons, these are the three strands that connect together to create the civil law system. And then comes the most controversial thing. There is a correct way to look at property. There is a proper way to look at property. There is a proper way to look at obligations. There is a proper way to look at status of persons. But the Antichrist system has its own interpretation of property. It has its own interpretation of obligations, and it has its own interpretation of the status of persons.
Of course, and I bet with you, for everything that I have, and I don't have much, that view of the Antichrist system is 180 degrees opposite to what the Bible teaches.
Absolutely. So where does this idea of three strands of middle modern civil law come from? It actually comes from God. This is the controversial part of what we're talking about here. It actually comes from God, because everything that is true and real comes from God. Property does come from God.
Exactly. That's why the Antichrist is going to take away our property.
Yes. And he's doing it at the moment with using the system that he's now using inside the public system.
Sure, because we don't owe anything. We don't own anything anyway, Robert, because everything that we so-called own, we have paid for with debt.
Yes.
Because
yes.
we don't even have real money. Yes. We have debt notes.
Okay. So these three, as Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, you would have no power except God gives it to you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So all of the leaders of the world, they know what the law is. And the architects of the global system, they know what the law is. But they cannot create a better thing. They can only corrupt something which already exists. So therefore, they create, they corrupt the law of property. They corrupt the law of obligations, and they corrupt the status of persons.
Isn't that also one of the reasons why God says there's nothing new under the sun?
There's nothing new, yeah, of course.
Everything that is already was there.
Yes, exactly.
You cannot invent something new because only God can create things.
Yes.
Man cannot create anything new. He
Absolutely.
Can only give new names to old stuff.
Right. So these three strands of modern civil law come from God, and they come into our consciousness, into our society, into our public life, but they come in a form which is not pure. It is actually, it offers a little bit of benefit. Property offers, of course, property offers some benefit. You have a property or you don't have a property. You have a roof above your head or you don't have a roof above your head. Property comes from God, but it's not fully explained or not fully developed in the civil procedure. If you want to stay inside the public system, you will have an imperfect understanding of property. You will have an imperfect understanding of obligations, and you will have an imperfect understanding of the status of persons. So all of these three things come from something that is greater than the law. What do I mean by greater? What can be greater than the law? Greater than the law, the fulfillment of the law is greater than the law. The fulfillment of the law is greater than the law. Equity is the fulfillment of the law. In fact, the how many times in the New Testament does it say that Jesus did this to fulfill the law, to fulfill the law, to fulfill the prophecy, mm-hmm. to keep the, I think it's 225 times, something like that in the Gospels. So to fulfill the prophets, to fulfill these things, equity in law, if you read a law book, equity follows the law. So the law is wonderful. The law is teaching us. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. These things are coming. And then they arrive, and they're there, and they're available. And this is the problem. We're going back to the barbarian world of rough justice. When we have equity, we've had equity in the New Testament for the last 2,000 years. We've had available to us something better than the rough justice of the civil procedure. But the civil procedure is here because there's a bankruptcy. That's why the civil procedure is here in the kindergarten. It's to try to help us. It can't help us very much, but it reminds us that there is a law. Does that make any sense?
So far, yeah.
I'm grateful that there's a law of property. I'm grateful there is a law of obligation and status of person, but it's not perfect. It's only diluted benefit. It's not the full benefit. You can't have the full benefit of equity while you're in the kindergarten. If you're still a child, you will not be treated as an adult or a grown-up man. And we are still in the public law. We don't know what private law is because we're in the kindergarten. We are subject to other people. We don't know ourselves the things that we need to know. Because we are still in the kindergarten. This is what St. Paul is telling us. We have to get rid of, we have to have a better understanding of the law. We have to have a better understanding as Christian people. We have to. If we don't understand what Christ has done for debt, if we don't understand that, then we are debt slaves. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
I honestly believe that Christ paid for the sins of the world. He paid for it. There were no big banks at that time. There were none. He paid for these things. Do you mean that every mortgage... Do you have mortgages in Germany? I suppose you do, yeah?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Right, okay. Do you mean that Jesus Christ has paid for every mortgage in Germany? Absolutely. How many people will believe that? How many people can believe that Jesus Christ has paid for every mortgage in Germany? How many people can believe that? Do you know what the word mortgage means? Mort, that means dead, right?
Mm-hmm.
You are presumed to be dead if you still believe that you can pay the mortgage with the monopoly money, which is made from what? Tissue paper?
I think the terms like mortgage, Robert, I think the terms like mortgage and so all go back to the Sestakev Act.
Yes, they do. Absolutely.
Where that was enacted after the big fire in London in 1666. And it was said that if you do not declare yourself within 7 years as a living person, you will be seen as a dead person.
Do you know?
And that's why the Roman Catholic system sees us all as zombies.
Well, if you go more deeply into this three things, this property, obligations, status of persons. If you go to obligations, who started the civil law in the first place? The man who started the civil law for the Roman Catholic Church, the inventor, the architect of the civil law system, was actually Justinian.
Mm-hmm.
Justinian, the emperor Justinian. He lived between 482 and 565.
Mm-hmm.
Justinian. Yeah? He came 200 years after, let's go a little bit earlier. Diocletian, you know Diocletian, the Roman emperor Diocletian. He was an evil bastard, no?
Yeah, name me one Roman emperor who wasn't an evil bastard.
Diocletian, the Roman emperor, lived between 244 and 312. He was the ruthless persecutor of the Christians.
He is the one who initiated the 10 years war that is mentioned in Revelation 2, this 10 days of tribulation that they will have. And rightly after Diocletian then came Constantine. And with Constantine came the view that when you cannot kill them, infiltrate them.
Yeah.
And by that, the Roman Catholic pagan system at that time baptized itself with the veil of Christianity, and since then calls itself the Holy Roman Empire and calls itself holy and Christian, where Roman Catholic Church is absolutely not Christianity.
Diocletian was the architect of a system of bishops. In fact, you can go, if you can check it out on Google Books, you will see there's a book called Diocletian and the Roman Recovery. How was, there were architects who were trying to save the collapse of the Roman Empire. Diocletian was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
His idea, it was a good idea. It seemed to work. He thought it was a good idea. He would reinvent the name of bishop. He would invent bishops everywhere. He would make bishops.
Mm-hmm.
The bishop would be the tax gatherer for the Christian bishop. They were pagans, but he would invent bishops. Diocletian's system of inventing bishops started in 300, just before the Council of Nicaea.
Mm-hmm.
And then after he created the system, which he spread everywhere, thinking that that will fix the dying Roman Empire, which was splitting into East and West, he would make bishops everywhere, and that would solve the problem. They would collect revenue like tax. That was Diocletian's system. And then he retired to his palace in Zagreb, which was in Yugoslavia.
Mm-hmm.
Diocletian. 200 years later, that didn't really work very well because people were not interested in the Roman Catholic system. Only some people were interested in it. But early Christians were not very interested in what was happening in Rome at that time. 200 years later comes another architect to save the Roman Empire, and he was Justinian. But Justinian is working from Byzantium, from the eastern side of the... But his idea was different from Diocletian. He was going to make a new system. He would call it civil law. And that's what you have today in Germany.
Oh, yeah.
The civil law was created by Justin, and he wrote a book called The Corpus Juris Civilis, the body of civil law, from which later your canon lawyers were greatly influenced by these people. They got these things from here, from the civil law, which is the modern name for a collection of works in law issued between 529 534 by the order of Justinian Eastern Roman Empire, designed to marry together the broken Eastern and Western Roman Empire by the Emperor Justinian, and which is still today in place across most of Europe and the rest of the world through the civil system that you have today in Germany and in most of Europe, and even here in England, increasingly here in England, because it's going worldwide, this system. The civil system.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting, no? And in so if you look closely into that system that Diocletian created, let's try to find it. Where did he describes? Ah, yes. Justinian, in his book on civil law, book three, section 13, invents what he calls obligations. Justinian invents obligation. What is an obligation? He defines the obligation: we are bound by necessity of performing some act according to the laws of the state. And he then separates the obligations into four different kinds. They are contracts, quasi-contracts. Quasi, you know what the word quasi means?
Yeah.
Quasi. Contracts, that means a real contract. There's nothing wrong with contracts. What is a quasi-contract? A quasi-contract is a document that looks like a contract, but it's not really a contract. A fake contract. And the reason I mentioned quasi-contract, did you know that every mortgage on the planet today is a quasi-contract? It's not a contract. It's an agreement. It's called a mortgage agreement. It's not a contract. Quasi-contract. That's a deep subject. If we were talking about mortgages, that would be a very interesting subject. I'm very interested in this subject.
Yeah, but I guess then we would take another few hours for this.
yeah. Quasi. So he invented... So he knew that there had to be real contracts for the, you know, the privileged people. They had to be able to make real contracts. But for the rest of the people, you will have quasi-contracts. Everybody with a mortgage, they will tell you that you have a contract with the bank. How can you make a contract with a bank? Can you meet a bank? Can you fall in love with a bank? Can you get engaged to a bank? Can you have a conversation with the bank? Do they exist? I mean, you know what I mean. If you make a contract, you have to make a contract with a man or a woman. That's what a contract is in law, in God's law. you can only make a contract with an individual.
Absolutely.
But a mortgage is you are claiming to make a contract with a bank. They have 3,000 solicitors working for them. Who is the bank? No, the solicitor is representing the bank. Okay, so who is the bank? Can you bring the bank into the courtroom? You want to talk to this bank. But he doesn't exist. You see what I mean? It's a quasi-contract. If everybody knew that every mortgage is a quasi-contract, we could have a real discussion. But people don't know. And if they know, they don't care. And the inventor of this idea was Justinian. The Roman Catholic Justinian. The last attempt to marry together the East and Western Roman Empire in the 5th century of the Christian era, 6th century of the Christian era.
Are still trying to do that, Robert.
They're still trying.
They are working on it very hard because they need that for their new world order.
Okay, now
which is actually just the old world order restored, something that most people even do not understand today.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So, let's go back again to our period of the end of the 19th century.
1895, yeah.
1818-something, right. So, in 1870, here in England, something enormous happened, but you never hear about it in the history books. It was the formation of the Supreme Court of England. That happened in 1870, 1870. Nobody ever talks about the Supreme Court of England. And 3 years later, in 1873, the Parliament in England created the Judicature Act. This is for judges. Judicature Act of 1873 and another Judicature Act of 1875. So the judges now come into the High Court in England and they take their seats in the High Court of England and these things, very few people know about the relevance of these things. And in America, at the same time, the Jesuits in America, who controlled the universities in America, from the very beginning, they controlled the universities. They also controlled the legal or law journal, contents of the law journals. So England's position with equity was very different from the Roman Catholic system. England respected God's law for example, private property, families, God's law. That was the English system. And England will not compromise with Rome on that question. Ever in the history of mankind, they will never compromise about that. So this part of the law of England is absolutely correct to this day. To this day, they still have the system of private respect for family property, inheritance, and all of that. So England has done many bad things, but this one, they've got it absolutely 100% correct. And so the Jesuits wanted to destroy the English, still want to destroy the English understanding of equity and the law of property and private international law and all of these areas that nobody understands. Nobody talks about these things because they're so busy reacting to what the state is doing in the kindergarten.
Okay, can I ask a question here, Robert? We are approaching about the full hour, and I think we will delay another part of your explanation to another broadcast.
Sure.
But I want to ask you one question in regards to what you've just said. and the regard of the Jesuit control, and that you say that England has always kept his equity and his property laws,
yes,
according to the word of God.
Yes.
In that regard, how do you see the exit of Great Britain from the European Union last year?
The exit of Britain from the European Union, in the public sense, is going to be a complete disaster, because they will debate this in the Parliament and nothing will happen and everybody will be disappointed. And that is correct. Everybody will be disappointed, because everybody in the kindergarten is always going to be disappointed. But in the grown-up world, in the adult, or the, how would you say, in the high school, this is brilliant news. It shows that England, fine, or this country, actually said no. They said no. So it doesn't change anything, but it proves that there's something, there's some life still left in the system of this country.
Well, it's interesting that you say that, because when this Brexit happened last year, I was thinking of Daniel chapter 2. In verse 42 it says, "And as the toes of the feet were part of iron, part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken." Mm-hmm. We are speaking about, yes, the Roman Catholic kingdom, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
"And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave unto another, even as iron is not mixed with clay." Mm-hmm. So they tried through the last centuries, by intermarriage of the different European kingdom king families, to cleave to another, and it did not work. They could never reach a union. There never was a real European Union, right?
That's right. Yes.
And now all of a sudden we have this Brexit last year, and I thought, isn't this another part of fulfilling the words Daniel spoke in Daniel 2?
Absolutely. Because one day, the potential in the United States, I was talking to an American yesterday, he was saying the law of England is so important at the highest level of the United States of America. If you're talking about equity and the Supreme Court of the United States, and it all goes back to the law of England, and I can show you in every state. So potentially, you know, when there will come a time when the feet of the image will be smashed to pieces by a stone, no? Is it not?
The stone not honed with hands, of course.
Yeah,
he will smash into the statue's feet and smash the whole statue into thousands of pieces, and from that will grow a stone that will be around the whole world, and that's the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Absolutely.
Well, absolutely. Yeah. Let me finish this hour, because I know you're concerned about the 1 hour.
I'm not concerned. You were concerned about that before.
But let's have a look at, where is it? It's somewhere here on the very first page of this book. I think it's this book. It's a quotation from Amos about, here it is. Yeah, see, Psalm 96. "The Lord reigns. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. He will judge the people with equity." How can you judge the people with equity? Sounds impossible. You can't. Equity is not a judgment system. Equity is, and yet there will be a judgment system. This is a beautiful verse, this one.
That was Psalm 96. Which verse, please?
Psalm 96, 10.
10.
I don't know if it's in your King James Bible, but
it doesn't say the word equity in King James. That's why I'm looking for it.
what does it say in the King James?
Well, you're speaking about the verse 10 in Psalm 96, right?
Yeah, 96:10.
"Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established, that it shall not be removed.
Yes.
He shall judge the people righteously."
Righteously, okay. Righteously.
"Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar, let the fullness and the fullness thereof."
Sure. So this is a happy time. This is a time when, well, at least one translation We at least one translation of the Bible says that this is equity, but this what version is that? I'm not certain what it is, but it's not the King James. But yeah, there we are. So there's a happy time coming when this system that is developing now is not going to succeed. You have to, if you leave the Word of God, eventually you've got to come back to the Word of God, because they left the Word of God, right?
Absolutely.
So they have to come back to something that they've already corrupted, and they have to come back to equity. In the end of, when everything is finished, even the Roman, even the city of London is devastated, and London is no more, and England is devastated, and everybody devastated, but still they have to come back to equity in the end. That's my honest belief. What is equity? Equity is the kid outside the kindergarten. I keep saying these things. I know it's difficult to talk.
Yeah, but that's all right. I mean, telling the people to grow up is something that they often think they did already, and then they are confronted with knowledge and things that you are teaching here, and they say, "Oh, probably I have not grown up."
But people have grown up.
This is something that.
They don't like to believe that because everybody else is doing these things. It's normal to have a mortgage. It's normal to have credit ratings and credit standing, and it's normal to, you know.
Yeah, but what people don't understand, even when they want to have a mortgage, let them have as many mortgages as they want. I don't have one. I just rent my apartment here. But the point is, even when you paid your mortgage to the full, and then you are taxed on your property every year.
Hmm.
And when you do not pay your tax, what happens to your property?
If I know one man who 100% paid it. He lost the property just yesterday. He in Scotland. He paid for his house. He bought it over a 17-year period. He paid for it.
With a mortgage.
Not with a mortgage. He paid for it with installments of cash. And he finally paid it off. And then the local authority, because he didn't pay the local taxation, and they threatened him, if you don't pay the local taxation, we will take a court case against you. And they took a court case against him. And he fighting all of this, they said, okay, if you don't stop fighting, we will take your house from you. Mm-hmm. He said, you cannot take my house. I already paid for it. They said, no, we will take it. And they sold it.
Absolutely.
Yesterday, he told me, what are we going to do? And I said, oh, you know, we will talk about it. Honestly, yeah.
That is how the people do not understand. You can pay your whole life, your mortgage or whatever you use to pay your house or apartment or whatever it is. It never is yours, because if you do not do the payments afterwards, the taxation that Robert just spoke about, when you do not pay the taxes, they will take it away from you.
Yeah.
It doesn't belong to you. You don't have any property in this world. You don't have anything. So because you don't have anything, you shouldn't be afraid of losing anything, because you don't have anything in the first place.
it's very, very strange situation, that a man believes that he is the absolute owner of the property. he is the legal owner of the property.
Well, the point is, Robert, and we can make this short, everybody thinks that he's a sovereign, but the only sovereign in this world is the Pope.
Exactly. Yeah, but there is a way in equity to deal with these things, but it doesn't belong to the kindergarten, so I'm not allowed to talk about it at the moment.
Oh, you're not allowed to talk about it in the moment. What do you mean by that? Who restrains you, Robert?
Well, I mean, it would confuse people if you say to people that your mortgage is that you don't need to repay the mortgage because there's no contract.
I know. I've listened to things like this before. Listen, Robert, let's make it short. This would be interesting. I will pose a question in the comment section of the video. If the people want to hear more about, now you phrase this, what you were just talking about, say
no,
this? What
but
would
now
you
you now
talking
you're
about?
making big trouble for me now.
Yeah, absolutely, Robert. Because by that I oblige you to come back, and we will have more broadcasts on these. Because I think that at least with these last minutes, we really caught the attention of people who were hanging on there for this last hour.
Let me catch their attention with another minute or two, because
please.
Because you want to be controversial. Okay, I want to be controversial. Okay, put it this way. In England, if you go to a court today and you have not paid the mortgage and they're going to take away the property and they will say that next to you in the court, there will be somebody from the bank. Right? The guy is coming from the mortgage company, and he represents the mortgage company. And they will say, okay, this mortgage contract, we are going to give it to the bank. We're going to do that. This mortgage contract, if you say it's not a contract, they will say, no, it is a contract. Okay? They will say it is a contract, and the judge will finish, he will finish the court immediately, and his verdict will be, this mortgage contract must go to the bank. And then you will think, oh, I lost the case. You will think that you lost the case, right? If you go, can you imagine? Here am I telling you that there's no such thing as a mortgage contract. And the judge is telling you that there is a mortgage contract and you lost the property and we're giving it to the bank. It looks like you've lost the case, no?
It looks like that, yeah.
Looks like you've lost it. Right. Actually, the judge is helping you. Now, what do I mean that he's helping you? The judge is telling you that, yes, it's not really a contract, but we want to help you because if this is not a contract, you don't have the rights which belong to a contract. Therefore, we will make it into a contract for you. Because if you don't have a contract, you don't have the rights of somebody who has a contract. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So the judges is actually trying to help you by making it into this quasi-contract into a real contract, hoping that you will wake up and now start to use the rights which belong to somebody if they really have a contract. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, and I think we should talk about these rights
that people have
when they really have a contract.
Yeah, when you really have a contract.
On another show of Hour of the Truth, and leave our people sitting in the chair, waiting, hoping for that we will come together again, Robert. I know that you don't have that much time, and it has been quite a while since we have been together for our first two broadcasts, but I very much appreciate that you have made the time today on the Sabbath to come back and discuss these things with me. And I will end this broadcast right now, but I will leave the last few moments up to you so that you can say goodbye to our listeners and leave them wanting for more.
can I just leave you this controversial moment by saying that under the law, the biblical law, you can make a contract verbally with somebody else. It's when you go into words, it's when you write the words down on a piece of paper, that's when things start to get complicated.
That's right.
An agent can be appointed without writing, that is, by the spoken word. I mean, God created the world without writing it on a piece of paper, right?
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not that firm in the Bible study, but as far as I remember, when Abraham bought some land...
Yes.
They just shook on it.
Yes, that's right.
And that's actually where that whole tradition of let's shake on it comes from.
It's
sovereign people who exchange their will in a contract.
Precisely. They exchange their will in a... And then this beautiful thing in Corinthians, the letter killeth, but the spirit gives life.
Yeah.
And this is where the theologians are arguing about Greek verbs and Hebrew pronouns and all this kind of stuff, yeah?
Yeah, I believe that, yeah.
This is amazing. So contracts are usually made by verbal contract. That's how they did it for many centuries. But now the legal industry wants you to write it down. That's where it gets confusing, right?
And that's where you get in trouble. Yeah,
that's where you come into the jurisdiction of the legal industry. So.
Absolutely.
Anyway, so, thank you very much, Jörg. That was really interesting.
That was really interesting, Robert. I thank you very much for the contribution on the show, on Hour of the Truth today. And as always, I will leave your email address in the description box of the video, and I will run it as text through the video that the people can watch it. And when they have any serious questions, then please abstain from trolling or something else. If you have some real interesting questions, you can address Robert himself on his email address that is written in the description box of the video. And you will see that running through the picture here in the video while watching this. And then you can contact him for serious questions. Yeah.
And thank you. And if they have any complaints, they can give them to Jörg, because he is the one who's he's the one who's making the controversy all the time.
Okay. I get the complaints and you get the questions. That's all right.
Thank you very much.
That's all right. Thank you, Robert. And until next time.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.